Welcome back. In the last video, I mentioned that there were ways that we could essentially convert L-serine to D-serine. And it's not that we're the only organisms that can do this. In fact, there are lots of other organisms like bacterial cells that can actually do this readily. In fact, they, in large part, convert a lot of their L amino acids to D amino acids. Okay? And in general, in humans, when we do this to L-serine to make D-serine, this is going to be a pyridoxal phosphate-dependent racemization. Okay? And the enzyme that catalyzes this in humans is called serine racemase. Okay, and if you remember from the last video, I mentioned that the reason it's called a racemase is that effectively you're racemizing your concentration of serine. You're taking a lot of the L-serine and converting some of it into D-serine. So you're not going to actually make a racemic mixture, but I think it gets the point across. You're taking some of your L-isomers and converting them into D-isomers. So what this enzyme is going to do is it's going to take L-serine and it's going to isomerize the alpha carbon. So if we look here at serine, we see here's the alpha carbon in orange, okay? And we're basically going to take the L stereoisomer and convert it into a D. And this mechanism is dependent on pyridoxal phosphate, okay, which is one reason why you should definitely get your vitamin B6, right? Because B6 can get converted into pyridoxal phosphate. So you absolutely need B6 to do this, but that's beside the point. Okay, so at rest, the pyridoxal phosphate is going to be covalently bound in a shift base linkage to a lysine residue in the active site. So this should have a positive charge. It's covalently bound to a lysine residue. And there are, of course, residues in the active site that keep this oxygen with a negative charge, that keep this nitrogen of the pyridine ring protonated, and so forth. But effectively what's going to happen is we're first going to create the linkage between the L amino acid, in this case it's serine, and the pyridoxal phosphate. So the alpha amine of the serine is going to start off in the deprotonated state, and it's going to do a nucleophilic attack on this carbon of pyridoxal phosphate, and that's going to effectively kick these pi electrons onto the nitrogen that's part of the lysine. And so what you should generate is this linkage between serine and pyridoxal phosphate, but you still have the pyridoxal phosphate in a single bond to the lysine residue in the active site. So not only is the pyridoxal phosphate attached to the lysine, now you have the amino acid covalently attached, okay? And at this point, what's going to happen is you're going to have a beta elimination, okay? So keep in mind that there's a lone pair on this nitrogen that's part of this the lysine residue. Well, it's going to attack one of the protons that's on the alpha amine of the serine, and that's going to initiate the beta elimination, okay? So this is going to be a concerted process. It's an E2 elimination, bimolecular, and so forth. And what that's going to do is create a protonated shift base linkage between the serine amino acid and the pyridoxal phosphate. Now, what's important to keep in mind is that the serine at this point, or at least what was the serine, of course, now it's the shift base, but what was the serine has L stereoisomerism. Okay, so this carbon, again, that I'm putting, let me do it in purple. This carbon right here, this is the L isomer. We haven't changed the stereochemistry at that carbon. Everything's still the same, so it's still the L isomer. What I really want to do in this video is not have you memorize or learn a mechanism blindly, but to really understand this mechanism, because this hopefully should give you a lot of intuition on what's happening, especially with respect to changes in conformation and stereochemistry and how things exist in an active site. Now, bear in mind that this up here, what was serine, it's of course now a shift base, right? That's the L isomer, right? And so if we were to draw it in the active site let me do this, okay? Let's say that I have an axis right here that goes straight up, and that's my Z axis, right? And then let's say I have this axis, this is my X axis, and then of course going back and coming forward, that's of course the Y axis, right? Well, let's say for instance that the hydrogen this alpha hydrogen, keep in mind this is the alpha hydrogen, the alpha hydrogen alpha carbon bond, let's say that represents the z-axis, right? So what we're doing now is we're imagining the xy plane. We're imagining the xy plane. Well, imagine that the xy plane, imagine that we're looking at it straight on, and that plane is like this, right? That's the plane. That's the xy plane. That's this plane right here, okay? And of course, the hydrogen alpha carbon bond is going straight up perpendicular. In other words, the xy plane is perpendicular to the hydrogen carbon bond, okay? Because all the other groups have to exist at approximately 109.5 degrees away from the z-axis, right? Away from the carbon-hydrogen bond, they're all going to be below the xy plane, right? And what I want you to understand is that there's a base in the active site of serine racemase, okay? And the base is oriented above the xy plane, okay? In other words, it's on the positive. If this z right here, if this was the positive z, then the z vector of the base would be positive. It's above that plane, and that's really important for the catalysis. Okay, because if the base was on the bottom, if it was below the xy plane, this mechanism wouldn't work. Okay, so let's actually think about what might happen. Okay. So the base in the active site is going to deprotonate the alpha carbon. Okay, in other words, this base is going to abstract the proton from the alpha carbon. And what's going to happen, and we'll look at it here, is that the bond between the hydrogen and the alpha carbon is going to come and do a double bond rearrangement with the shift base. And we'll actually look at the rest of it on here. So these electrons come in here, and you get a double bond rearrangement in which you destroy this aromatic ring and make the quinone version of it. We essentially call it a quinonoid, okay? When you hear the term oid after a word, it usually means it's similar to something, but not exactly. So we would essentially call this right here the quinonoid, okay? It's a quinonoid version of the pyridoxal phosphate. Okay, and notice this conjugated double bond system. Okay, the conjugated double bond system that exists from here all the way through here, right? Everything's planar, right? Because everything has double bond character, right? It all has double bond character, so it's all planar. Okay, now if you were to actually look at this double bond right here, okay, this double bond right here, okay, that's what I have drawn right here. That's this, okay? Notice that if you were actually to draw that XY plane, all of those bonds, and that's basically these. Let me do those in red. These bonds right here, okay, all of those are in the plane. Okay, in other words, what you can say is that all of their Z vectors would be zero, right? They don't exist in the Z anywhere on the z-axis. They're in the xy plane, and in fact you could make the argument that the angular distance between each of these bonds is approximately 120 degrees, right? So they're all in the plane xy. So now what's happened is, and let me do this in red, so these bonds right here, all these ones, these are essentially they're all in the XY plane. So let's actually make the XY plane here, okay? All of these red bonds, okay? Basically picture those, okay? Picture those all in that XY plane, meaning that they don't, at least those bonds, don't have any Z value, right? Their Z value is zero because they're all in the XY plane, okay? And anything that would be above that plane, right, that would have a positive Z value, and anything below it would have a negative Z value. Well, in our first case right here, right, in our first case, the hydrogen, the alpha hydrogen, started out above the XY plane, okay? And actually so did the base that deprotonated that carbon, okay? But during the change in conformation of the enzyme, okay, what ends up happening is the base that originally did the deprotonation. Now it's protonated. But it repositioned itself with respect to the quinonoid ring. Okay, and that's actually what this is called. This whole ring right here, this is all called a quinonoid intermediate. Okay, and the reason it's called a quinonoid is because it's similar to a quinone, but it's not quite a quinone, so they add the oid at the end. So it's a quinonoid. But notice how all of this is just a conjugated pi bond system, right? So what does that tell you about its geometry? It's planar, okay? So all of this business over here, all of this business on this side of the nitrogen shift base, it's all planar, okay? So it's all flat, okay? Now what happened during this time is the change in conformation of the enzyme switched the protonated base to below the XY plane. Here, notice the base was above the XY plane, but now it's reoriented itself to below the quinonoid ring. Okay, so what's going to happen is, and let's look at the mechanism up here. There's going to be a double bond rearrangement in which we regenerate the aromaticity. Okay, so you get a double bond rearrangement, okay, of the pi bonds. But what's going to happen is this shift base is going to come out and abstract the proton from the base. But bear in mind that now the base that's protonated is below the XY plane, right? So effectively what's going to happen is when this pi bond comes out and abstracts the proton, you're going to get inversion of stereochemistry. So what will end up happening is you get something like this, okay? So when this pi bond came out and abstracted the proton from below the XY plane, you get a situation like this, and you flip the stereochemistry. Now let's for 1 minute imagine what would have happened if you didn't have that change in conformation. Let's say that instead of switching to where the protonated base was below the XY plane, let's for instance ask ourselves what would happen if it was above. Well, you would still have that double bond rearrangement to get rid of the quinonoid intermediate, right? But if you went and just protonated or reabstracted the proton from this base, you'd end up with this again, right? And that's not what we want. The whole reason that we have the ability to invert the stereochemistry is because of the change in conformation of the enzyme that facilitates the movement of this guy below the XY plane, okay? That's the only reason that's allowed to happen, okay? And what that generates, it generates this this part of the serine, and this part of the serine now has D isomerism, so it's the D isomer, okay? We've successfully isomerized the alpha carbon. But now what we have to do is we have to get rid of that shift base linkage, because we don't just want serine attached, or we should say D-serine attached to pyridoxal phosphate, we want free D-serine, right? We don't want it in that linkage. So we have to reattach pyridoxal phosphate to the enzyme which had the lysine residue. So what's going to happen is the lysine residue is going to do a nucleophilic attack on that pyridoxal phosphate carbon, forcing these pi electrons onto the nitrogen, right? And then that's going to give us this right here. And at this point, we're effectively going to reverse the initial step of the mechanism. So we're basically in this step just going to reverse the first step of the mechanism, okay? And if you want more elucidation on that and you want proof, go back and look at the first step of the mechanism. You'll find we're just reversing it, okay? And in fact, we had a structure almost identical to this. Go back and look and you'll see, okay? So this amine is going to deprotonate here. We're going to get a proton transfer and then loss of a leaving group. That's just the steps of a beta elimination, right? And our leaving group is going to be D-serine. Okay, so this molecule right here, this is D-serine, okay? And once again, we regenerate the resting state of our pyridoxal phosphate, which is in a shift-based linkage to a lysine residue of the enzyme serine racemase,